Summertime. Oh, oh. It's dinner party tonight. It's Randy Sharp. It's summertime. Today we're going to be making a beautiful, very simple supper for the summer. The components are a lovely sort of cheese, nuts, and smoked fish, but fancy little plate. Some radish crudité, piquant, summery. Some beautiful grilled ribs marinated overnight. And then the main course is lemon chicken under a brick, fancy and delicious. And we're gonna serve that with a tomato salad, a green salad, and very fancy little onion little tarts. For dessert, what else would you have on a summer evening? Panna cotta, which means cooked cream. It's not hard, don't be afraid of it. We're gonna serve that with lemon curd, which is like lemon sauce. And boy, does it make a splash, and it's beautiful, and it's the perfect ending to a summer evening supper. S-E-S. I suggest you do a couple things the night before. You don't have to, but as I've said before, it makes things a little bit easier. Two things I would suggest here are marinating the chicken, which really should marinate for about 8 hours. But don't sweat it if you forget to do it. 1 hour is enough. And the ribs. And this is how you do it. It's very easy. You take a spatchocked chicken. These are the chickens from Hudson and Charles, the butcher shop of Kings. This is a pastured chicken, meaning that it runs around like in a movie about a farm. It's like a running around chicken. No house, and no nothing. It's quite small. It's expensive, as it should be. And spatchocked means butterflied, okay? It means opened up like a book with the backbone and the ribs removed, flattened. It's for the grill. Ask your butcher, who you've tipped, to spatchock your chicken for you. Then you take some nice flaky salt and liberally salt both sides. Try to have a clean hand and a dirty hand. One hand touches the chicken, one hand doesn't. Pepper this side. You don't have to be precious about this. It's gonna go in a liquid marinade, so don't worry too much. You're going to zest a couple of lemons. Add about 1/3 cup of olive oil. 1/3 cup is about 8 seconds squeezing from here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And to that, you are going to add the juice of 2 lemons. This is a variation on Ina Garten's Tuscan lemon chicken. It's not really a variation. It's a great recipe. We are going to put a little rosemary. I happen to have a rosemary plant right here. Basically, you're gonna strip this like this. You never use this. If somebody does that, it means they don't know what they're doing. Gather it into a bowl like this, screw it up real tight, and roughly chop it, family style. That means don't spend too much time worrying about it. Put that straight into your marinade. I'm gonna put a little bit in the bottom of this bowl, pick up the chicken, and I'm gonna put it in this bowl like this and kind of move it around. Take the rest of your marinade and pour it on top. And then you just leave that, preferably overnight, but if you don't have time to do it overnight, still do it, because it'll affect it as you're grilling it. And that's basically what that should look like in its marinade, respectfully resting before it is magnificently presented. The other thing I would suggest doing the night before is marinating ribs. Now, I know from experience, you really don't have to do this the night before. Does it make a difference? Who knows? All right, take your ribs, and you're going to use our old favorite, salt and pepper. So you're gonna liberally salt both sides. Very salty. So pepper and salt both sides. Then you're gonna take a shallot. Nobody's gonna see it. So you're just gonna do some rustic. You can basically cut it down the center and then just cut rounds like this. Very easy. Now, I make these ribs and people flip out. And I'm gonna tell you one of the ingredients, hoisin. The other thing we're going to use is something called a kefir lime leaf. Controversial name, you can look it up why. Kefir limes are funny, bumpy limes, they're delicious, but it's one of the few plants in the world where we use both the leaves and the fruit for cooking. And it has an extraordinary, unbelievable aroma. So I'm gonna go and get a kefir lime leaf from my hanging on for dear life kefir lime plant in the back. So this is a kefir lime leaf. I mean, it smells. Smell that. Seriously.
Oh, neat.
Isn't that amazing? Yeah. Okay, so what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to kind of fold it into a random packet, and I'm just going to chop it like this. Beware the chiffonade! Okay. It doesn't really matter, because nobody's going to see it. It's going to be grilled off. But when you cut it, it releases the incredible aroma. Take a plastic bag. Mop up as much salt and pepper that you dropped on the wax paper. And carefully insert the ribs into the bag. Then you're going to sprinkle half of your shallots on one side and half of your shallots onto the side. There you go, love. Sprinkle them away. Half of your kefir lime leaves on one side and half of your kefir lime leaves onto the side. Okay. Hoisin sauce, I didn't make it. Then you go like this. Okay, so it's smeared. And then you go like this. You want to make sure you don't see any of the, clearly see any pink. You want it to be all hoisined. Push the air out. This has a hole in it, so I'm being careful. And then you can put this in your fridge overnight, the night before your party. When you get up in the morning, take it out of the refrigerator because it has to come to room temperature and flip it. And then release the air again. This way, the sauce, it's not on one side the whole time. You have now marinated your ribs and you are either going straight to bed or you're going to have a glass of wine and watch the season finale of Botched or Housewives of New York. Good morning, good morning. It's a shame to stay up late. This is the morning of your dinner party. The very first thing you're gonna do is take all the meat out of the fridge so it can come to room temperature, and then you're gonna remember to take your puff pastry, this is the best one, out of the freezer and put it in the fridge. Do not thaw it on the counter. What's panna cotta and how do you make it? Well, I'm gonna show you. Panna cotta means cooked cream, and it's very simple and it's a beautiful, elegant dessert. It's almost like a custard and it needs to set in the fridge, firm up for about 4 hours. It'll be softer if you do it for less, and if you do it for longer, it turns into another dessert, which is a very firm custard. 4 hours, three to four hours. So try and gauge your preparing of it with that in mind. So how do you make panna cotta? That's the question. The first thing you need to know is it's not vegetarian. Most people think it is, but it's not vegetarian because it has gelatin, which is made from the hooves of cows. You can use agar-agar. It's hard, but you can do it if you want it to be veggie. So here's how you make it. You take 1 cup of cream and you put it into a saucepan. And then you measure out 2 more cups because you need 3 cups of cream to make panna cotta. It's straight cream. Just a newsflash, this size is 2 cups. So there we are, now it's ready. Then I am going to bloom the gelatin. I'm gonna sprinkle this gelatin on the surface of the milk and I'm gonna let it sit, the cream, and I'm gonna let it sit for around 5 minutes. So here we go. So then I'm just gonna sprinkle it, and this, they don't tell you this in any recipe book, but I learned this. You wanna do a very light layer, and then you want to turn your saucepan like this. See how it makes like a meniscus on top there? And you want to try and get it evenly across the surface. My warning is, do not dump it into the cream. You will have a ball of melted gelatin. You don't want that. You are now going to turn on sort of low, medium-low heat underneath it. The purpose of this is you are melting the gelatin, which has been rehydrated by the cream, into the cream because you don't want lipid, you know, globs of gelatin floating in panna cotta. It's not nice. So take your time and let it melt so that when you stir it, you see no globules of gelatin. That's the key. So like right now it's melting around the edges. I guess it takes about 5 minutes to melt. See how it's like a skin? You can kind of gently move it off the sides so that it's, but don't be rough with it because you don't want clumps. Keep it nice and thin, the layer. A good tip for making any cream, including custard cream for ice cream and stuff, you want to make sure it's not blazing hot under here. This is pretty hot, so I'm going to turn it down a tiny bit while we're melting the gelatin. You don't want it to boil because it makes such a mess, you can't even believe it. I'm now whisking because the gelatin has melted enough that I can whisk it. I can still clearly see it, but we're getting close. I'm looking for gelatin by tipping it a little bit and kind of looking for globules. You don't want to see any things like that. That's a globule. This is now ready for the rest of the ingredients. In fact, it's boiling. I want to take that off. So then you want to add the other 2 cups of cream to this hot cream. Put that back on your heat. You're going to put in 3/4 cup of organic sugar. So you don't have to use bleached sugar. In fact, I wouldn't use Domino white sugar. A, it's made by slaves, and B, it's bad for you. You want to gently stir this in. And what you're doing now is you're melting the sugar because you've already melted the gelatin. The magic King Arthur flour vanilla plus, which contains flecks of vanilla seed. My friend Bang worked in a restaurant and he served a vanilla-flecked panna cotta, and the lady said, "Excuse me, there's dirt in my panna cotta." And he said, "It's fresh vanilla." And she looked at him blankly and she goes, "There's dirt in my panna cotta." So we're gonna put a little dirt in the panna cotta. You can also slice open a vanilla bean and scrape the seeds in if you feel so inclined. I'm gonna wait for the sugar to be melted. And the way I do that is I kind of feel on the bottom. Do I feel any sugar here? The other thing I'm going to look for is I'm going to pick up the pot and I'm going to look at it sideways. Do I see steam rising from the pot? Not yet. What I'm looking for is the first tendrils of steam. Ooh, then it's done. I don't know, 10 minutes, 15 minutes maybe? When your sugar has melted, your panna cotta is essentially ready. What you're going to do is turn the heat off. And you're gonna leave it to sort of sit in its own personality for a while until it comes down in temperature a little bit. And then you're gonna decant it into your little containers. I think lemon curd would go really well drizzled on top of those panna cottas. Lovely, summery, you know? So let's go on an adventure and make lemon curd, which I have never made. The recipe that I've selected is Epicurious. It's from Gourmet 2001. Does it work? No one knew. Here we go. It's very simple. Whisk together 1/2 cup of lemon juice, 2 teaspoons of finely grated lemon zest, 1/2 cup of sugar, and 3 large eggs. Can we do that? I think we can. All right, and it says whisk those together and then stir in the butter and cook over moderate heat. So I'm gonna pick up this butter, which is 6 tablespoons of butter. It doesn't say anything about adding it in little amounts. I'm gonna cook it 6 minutes on low heat so we don't scramble the eggs. The butter, she is melting. If you just turned up the heat to make the butter melt, you would make scrambled eggs with lemon. Blah, right? You have to heat eggs very gently if you want them to remain in a liquid state. So that's what we're doing. It's starting to look like lemon curd. Does seem like it's thickening a little bit. Do you see that? What do you call an escaped dwarf fortune teller?
What?
A small medium at large. Oh, smell that. It's almost there. So look, see? It's almost holding the shape. See that little line that remains in there? We're almost there. So I go like this. Look at that. Look at that. Freaking perfect, man. Dude, we made lemon curd. If it does seem lumpy, simply strain it. Put that in a container, and when it comes to room temperature, put a piece of cellophane flat on the surface, touching the surface of the lemon curd. I don't know, I've never done it before. I guess so it doesn't form a skin. And then you chill that until you're ready to put little drops of it on top of your panna cotta. Come on now, that's beautiful. Panna cotta. Don't try and pour it into the little containers from the saucepan or saucepan. It's very difficult. I like to pour it in a spouted thing. Pour it into these containers. You don't have to strain it. It just makes it extra safe in case you have globules. I'm using ramekins. We're going to take them out of the ramekins and serve them without the container. But I wanted to show you an optional container. I think these are so cute. These are these little weck jars. They just look really sweet. That's gonna be too high. That's not gonna set. So I'm gonna make it a little bit lower. I use this tray because taking these one at a time to the fridge is like a real pain in the ass. So here you go. Leave them uncovered until they're not just room temperature, but a little bit chilled, and then gently sort of drape some cellophane over the top. So those should be in the fridge for at least 3.5 hours to 4 hours. Too long and it's really pâte au crème. Too short and it's liquid. So 3.5 hours minimum. Something magical is going to occur. If it's before 4 o'clock and you have made your panna cottas and put them in the fridge to chill, you've made your lemon curd for the first time and put that in the fridge to chill, you have marinated your chicken, it's out of the fridge, it's coming to room temperature, you've marinated your ribs, they're out of the fridge, coming to room temperature, and it's before 4 o'clock, you can take a break. And what that means is you can watch perhaps Snapped or 48 Hours that you've DVR'd or Datelines, several Datelines, or you could walk your dogs if they're not sulking because you're shooting a cooking show in their house. Take a break until 4 o'clock. You're on the money. Okay, so it's after four. You've had your nice break watching your DVR'd 48 Hours and Datelines. You've returned to the kitchen. You're going to make tomato salad, which is a very, very, very easy, and it's a lovely sort of bright summer flavor. The first thing I'm going to do with this way too oversized knife is I'm just going to cut this like that and cut it lengthways a few times because I'm going to dice it. Set that aside. Now you have washed your tomatoes. They're all different kinds. Try to buy ones from the United States and organic ones if you can find them. So you're going to cut off the nose. This is the wrong knife. You're going to cut off the nose, and then you're just going to cut slices of tomato like this. And you're going to leave the top, and you're just going to throw them in a bowl. This one's juicy, but it's okay. And choose them for appearance, because this is a very visual dish, as you'll see. It's not even really a recipe. So I'm just literally slicing tomatoes. You can use the ends for fresh tomato sauce if you want, but you want really beautiful slices. Mix them up a little bit if you have more red. And then these guys, which are from usually from Canada, don't buy them from Mexico because they use really crazy pesticides there. You know, we make them and then we can't use them here because they're illegal. So we sell them to places like Costa Rica, Mexico, Chile. They all use deadly pesticides. Don't buy stuff from there. Unless it's organic, especially chili. These guys are from Canada. I like the way they look. What I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna cut them in half and throw them in. Mixing up the colors in pooty poo. Should be chunky, country style. okay, good. I'm gonna take my little shallot that I diced very finely, and I'm just gonna sprinkle the shallots over. And what you're gonna do is you're gonna essentially soften this with salt. Take a lot of salt, like this, in your hand. And do that twice, at least. Kind of shake it around a little bit. Move out the pieces around, turn them upside down, and do a little tiny bit more. You're gonna put a lot of cracked pepper, heavy duty. And you're gonna squirt a little bit of olive oil on it, just like this. Okay? Then you're gonna kind of shake it around again, and you're gonna leave it. You can put it in the fridge, but it needs to sit and kind of draw liquid out for an hour, maybe. Otherwise, all the salt's sitting on the top and you don't want that. So it does some weird magic thing where it turns into a great salad, I'm telling you. Right now it's gonna sit in its loveliness for about 2 hours. And now's a good time to cut up another kind of tomato that you're gonna use to make your dressing. I like these little cherry guys. The orange ones are beautiful. I threw a couple in the salad also. Basically, you're just gonna put a lot of salt on them until they begin to drain themselves of juice, and you're gonna use that to create salad dressing, like this. That's plenty. You've cut them all in half. You're gonna do a similar preparation where you're gonna cover them in a lot of salt. About that much for that amount. You're gonna hit it with some pepper. Okay, I'm flipping this around so that it gets fully coated. It's already juicy. I'm now going to put some olive oil on, a little bit. Think we're making salad dressing, okay? I'm gonna squirt some Dijon mustard. Oh, it came out. Excuse me, Zach. And then I'm gonna put a little bit of white wine vinegar in there. Now, I'm telling you, this is going to magically transform into really good salad dressing. Oops. I might put a little bit of thyme in it. So remember, you never serve the stick. So we're just gonna peel. The prince of the house wants to come back in. Come on in. Oh, it's gonna be good. Oh, the fresh herbs. Look at that. Okay, then we're just gonna toss it again. And the liquid, which you can see sort of is starting to look like salad dressing already. Okay, and you're gonna set that aside for an hour. So you wanna make salad, but here's the deal. You can buy salad and wash it, especially if you got it at the farmer's market, because it's full of ladybirds and bugs. But you can also buy salad that is lavé trois fois, or triple washed. There are still legends of people finding Band-Aids in them and stuff, so I'm not gonna say you should always do that without looking at it. This is triple washed Earthbound Farm, which is actually a conglomeration of farms. This can be confusing, this organic thing. And it is half and half, moitié, moitié, beautiful words here. Baby spinach, jeune épinard. Come on, man. Anyway, and spring mix. This is something your guests don't want to see. It doesn't matter how clean it is, they don't want to see it. Look, salad. Take a quick look for Band-Aids and any rotten leaves. This looks fantastic. And just sort of gently cover it until you're ready to serve it. And I would also recommend not dressing it until you're just about to serve it, because it can essentially cook the lettuce in a weird way. They don't want to see you opening some plastic container. I mean, what do you think this is? It's a gourmet cook in here. We don't open a plastic thing like this. It's out of the question. So it's now essentially 4:45 if you started making the tomato things at 4. And we're going to make the contents and the frame for a very sort of prissy little tart, onion tart, that will serve as your starch for your summer Sunday supper, or summer supper, summer evening supper, SES, okay? And we're gonna do that by cutting up a bunch of onions. So you're gonna line up scallions so that the roots are all in the same line, and you're gonna cut the roots off. Get rid of the roots. You are then going to take as many as you can safely chop at once. This is probably too many. And you're gonna cut rounds like this. Move your hand. Up until they separate away from the white part. I don't use that. It's dirty and it's been in the deli for God knows how long. The bottom I peeled, so I know it's cleaner. You're gonna put this in a bowl. We're now going to make bigger pieces, but they're going to be equally careful. I cut the onion in half. I peeled off the skin. I checked it. Hello. And then I proceeded to cut very nice slices. Not too thick, not too thin. Take your time, because you want this to be kind of Frenchy, little tarty, party, lardy, not something that you can, not rustic. We're not looking for rustic here. We're looking for kind of fancy. Okay, I'm loving the fact that this sweet onion has a lovely green center. I think that's really beautiful for our tarts. Same thing with this other onion. I may or may not use it, but remember when I cook them down, they'll shrink. This is the contents of your tart, period. Well, some herbs and salt and pepper and olive oil. Ooh! Ah, it squirted right in my face! Ah! I have in my palm a handful of sweaty flour, and I'm just going to sprinkle a little bit of flour on the surface like this. Not too much, because you don't want clumps of uncooked flour in your puff pastry. Use Dufour, it's the best. Oh, this is perfect. It's defrosted perfectly. Okay, we've done this before. It's folded like this. You unfold it. Don't be afraid of it. It's not gonna hurt you. Okay, that's what it looks like. Puff pastry. Okay, I'm sort of drying it with flour. Now you see it broke, don't panic. And you can look back at the little fruit tarts we made in the chicken dinner. Don't panic, nothing bad's gonna happen, okay? You can easily just kind of push it back together, like that. And you're just thinning it ever so slightly. But you wanna make sure you can still lift it. That's why you put the flour down. Oh, shoot. Okay, now that means we need more flour. Okay, I'm hurrying because when puff pastry warms up, you cannot use it. That's why you thaw it in the fridge. Now, I am using these. These are non-stick tart pans. They're approximately 45 cents at a decent kitchen supply. These are non-stick. You're gonna place your thing like this, and you're gonna cut a bigger circle than it, okay? And then you gotta hurry, because if it heats, it's no good. And you're gonna drape it in here like this, and then you're gonna set it aside. We're gonna clean it up in a second. They are gonna be prissy, but right now, you're just getting them in the form. Cut off any gross excess, like this is a gross excess here. And you're gonna take those forms and you're gonna put them back in the refrigerator so that you can work with them again. They need to be cold. All right, back in the fridge they go. So let's go ahead and sweat down the filling for those tarts while they chill. It's around the right amount of time for them to chill, so let's try that. Hot pan. Oh God, it got hot really fast. It's got stuff in it. This is too small, by the way, but as usual, it doesn't really matter. We're going to look at how much onions we have, and we're going to eyeball how much olive oil there should be. Start with 4 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I'm going to dump in, oh, I made a mess. I'm going to dump in all the onions. Look at them. How salty do you want them to be? It's not that hard, all right? Put some salt in. And remember, if you mess it up, just get Chinese food. I'm cracking a little pepper in here. And I'm just gonna saute these for a little bit. This is a very small pan for this amount. It's hard to do the chef flip in here. Cook it down. I might throw in a little white wine vinegar. Who cares? Should we put some Madeira in? This might be really good. I'm gonna taste one. Oh my God, it's really good. A little more salt. Taste as you go. Never send something you didn't taste. Someday I'll make a big confession to you. Most people would add balsamic vinegar to make it brown. I'm not gonna do that, because I'm not a big balsamic vinegar person. And you're just gonna sweat this down until the onions are floppy. So now it has to cook down. See how wiggly it is? It's wiggly, wiggly. Wingly, wangly, wongly. Wimbly, wambly. Hello, Dave. Okay, it's cooked. You see how they're sweated down, slightly translucent? I threw a bay leaf in there for flavor. And you are going to just leave that on the stove until you are prepared to assemble your tarts, which will be much closer to dinner. By now it's probably 10 of 6, quarter of 6. You have people invited for 7 or 7:30. Sometimes you just have to take a break. You don't want to explain it. You just sit down. 5 minutes can restore you to full strength. Take those 5 minutes. Have a little glass of wine. This is white wine, obviously. Have a tea, if you don't drink, a soda. Or just sit down and watch maybe part of a Snapped episode. This isn't a full break, just a small break. You deserve it. Mm. Okay, so it's about 6 o'clock. Your guests are going to be arriving soon. You've watched a few minutes of Snapped or something, and you sort of have to buckle down now. It's around 6. Time to get your appetizers ready, your radishes and your attractive plate of cheese and et cetera. So we're just gonna go through that very quickly, starting with radishes. The lowly radish, one of my favorite vegetables, spicy. It's very good for your system, it's good for your digestion and for your heart. You probably have to eat 400 pounds of them for it to actually have any effect, but it's a healthful food. Overlooked, but very beautiful. We're gonna make a really simple crudité with these, which simply means cut up vegetables, but it's kind of chic what we're gonna make. You're just gonna take your regular radish, you're gonna cut off the witch's nose, which is this.
Oh, who would dare to come and be bad with me in sight?
You're gonna leave a little bit of the stem because your guests are going to use that to pick up the crudité example. And you're going to cut through the radish and through the stem if you can. Now this one got more stem on one side than the other. And you're just going to arrange these as you cut them in a dish. This is the cutest little appetizer. So when you look at the top, you've cut off the greens and you're gonna get rid of the ones that look floppy or weird. See, now it looks nice. Cut off the witch's nose and cut straight down the middle. Anybody can do this, come on. People go, radishes? I had a guest over once and they go, radishes? Who'd want to eat radishes? And then they eat the whole plate. This is a nice one, good stem. Cut off the witch's nose and then straight down the center. Stem on both sides, look at that, come on. Oh, radishes are spicy. And radishes are good. Radishes are lovely. I'd eat them if I could every day. Oh, a radish, it makes me feel so happy. Oh, a radish, it makes me feel so gay. It's a little crowded here, but we're gonna make this so pretty, okay? Little bit of salt and pepper. Now this is a small tray, so you have to be kind of careful, but you wanna hit each radish with salt, because it will draw out some of the bitter, spiciness, okay? Like this. The panting you're hearing is from my dog, Vivian. You can already see them sweating a little bit from the salt. I'm gonna be more careful than normal with this, okay? And I'm gonna do like little tiny drips, but not too much. I'm not gonna go nuts like I normally do. Okay? Then I'm gonna crack pepper, even though they're quite spicy, all the way down. I'm gonna put a teeny weeny bit of white vinegar on it. Now, that's chic. I'm also gonna put some thyme flowers, remember? You string it like this, and you have all the flowers in your hand, never use the stick. Put some fresh thyme down the middle so it's very green and lovely. I didn't cook that, all I did was cut it up and put salt and pepper on it. Some people don't like radishes, they won't like it. If you like a radish, that is a delicious little thing to have with your Lillet or your soda or whatever it is you're drinking. So we're setting out all of our appetizers. We made the radishes, and I'm just gonna show you how to make really essentially already made things a little more fancy. So you took some salami and you cut some salami. Now that's very nice, but you can make it nicer. First of all, you want to include a small dish for the rind. And I always suggest taking a rind and placing it in the dish so people know what the dish is for. The other way you can make this special is by including a little bit of mustard, and people can put a little mustard on their cracker or their little pieces of bread, whatever you've chosen. and they can dress up their salami with a little seedy mustard. Not seedy crappy, but seedy like with seeds. And then we just have a cheese plate, which I've made slightly nicer simply by including an attractive random display of crackers and a pretty knife. If you just put the cheese down and the crackers in the box, that's, you know, make that little 2 minutes extra effort and it'll show and people will appreciate it. So that's your cheese plate. I'm just gonna show you how to present a special appetizer like smoked salmon, which is very nice on a summer evening. So you take out your salmon. This has been out of the fridge for a little bit. It's a little bit oily. I'm gonna just pat some of the oil off. It's natural oil. And I'm gonna show you how to do this. It's in slices, okay? They already sliced it. I'm gonna take this knife and I'm gonna slice all the slices down the center, okay? And then I'm gonna take each little piece like this. This is a big piece. And I'm just gonna kind of roll it. And I'm gonna set it like that, okay? That's how you do this. These are large pieces, but if you feel like they're grossly large, cut them in half. And then you just sort of twist it into like a little lump. And then you're gonna serve this with lemon and a little fork that people can use to pick up the pieces. Pick up the piece. How does that go? That's Average White Band for all of you people who don't know that song. And I'm gonna use a little lemon juice. It's okay that it's near the charcuterie, it's all right. So one of these I'm gonna use for presentation, so get rid of the seeds. One of them I'm gonna use to squeeze. Little squeeze, try not to hit the salami. Tiny bit of pepper just for appearances. And then you're gonna cut this like this. You could put this on a separate plate if you wanted to. And I'm just gonna grab a tiny little fork so they're not putting their hands in everything, all right? You don't want everybody's filthy mitts in all the food, it's gross. These are your lovely appetizers that you have set out for your guests. Beautiful crudité that's sweating like crazy with the salt, which is lovely. Some smoked nuts in this cute little dish. Your smoked meat plate, which is lovely charcuterie with very dark, looks good. Smoked salmon, little cracked pepper twisted into a lump with lemon, and a blue cheese. And those are your appetizers. But something else would go great with these appetizers, something special and summery and American. Ribs. We're gonna include ribs. Be a good time to open your wine now so that when they come in, they can have these things. They're waiting for the ribs to come off the grill. I use a propane grill. Some people think it's not grilling. Maybe they're right. It doesn't really bother me. I kill on that thing. So what do you want? If you have a charcoal grill, you should really get your grill going. Sort of 45 minutes before you put the ribs on, because right after the ribs is gonna go the chicken. So if it's a charcoal grill, you want a fairly large fire. If you have a propane tank, you wanna turn on your grill to high about 20 to 30 minutes before you put your ribs on. So judge that on your cooking time, whether it be before tarts or before you made the radishes or something. Make sure you preheat your grill or you're gonna be in trouble. And we are going to assemble tarts. Take them out one at a time. So you're gonna bring out your tart. Now you have this overhang that you created, but it's ice cold now, so you can work with it. Cut it so that it's sort of even all the way around, which you couldn't do before because it was too gooey. And then you're just gonna do this thing where you take the edge and you kind of fold it in on itself and it makes like a rounded top. It's very fancy looking. And then if you really wanna put the finishing touch on, every few inches, you go like this, okay? Every few centimeters, really. It's already softening. And into that lovely little container, I'm going to put some onions. Not too many. A few little onions like this. And then I'm going to return this to the refrigerator. You can use scissors as well. This is actually much better. You're just gonna turn the top like this and fold it in on itself like this. And that makes that lovely sort of pastry top like a ring sort of. And then I'm gonna go around and do height like we did before. Kind of pulling it, la 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 la. And then the indentations. Try not to get too much liquid. You just want mostly onions, not too much liquid, because the pastry is going to release butter because it's puff pastry. So you don't need any more liquid. These are going to be exquisite. Sorry about not playing with you guys today. Hey, what's your problem, dude? They're back in the refrigerator so they don't melt. And we'll take them out right before we cook them. Unlike everything else on the planet, puff pastry should be cooked directly out of the refrigerator or it melts and it'll never puff. The time has come to put the ribs on the grill. And these are really messy, so you want to do everything possible over the grill. You're going to do these presentation side down, which is basically meat side down. That's the bone side. This is the meat side. Here we go. It's going to make a big noise. I'm going to close this and let it do its thing. The most important thing about grilling, the mistake that people make, is they fuss with it and they move it around and they go, oh, it's going to stick, it's going to stick. Well, don't touch it until it moves easily. That's the trick, okay? So for instance, if I touch this, it's totally stuck on the grill. It won't move. That means it's not time to move it. So you don't move it until it easily peels up. That means it's sealed and it's ready to go. That's how you do this. Okay, I'm gonna check the ribs. Do they move? Not really. Oh, they moved. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pick them up and turn them to the other diagonal so they get the famous cross hatching. After I flip them, I'm just gonna repaint them with marinade. This is pretty messy, but there you have it. And what I'm gonna wait for now is for the bones to become exposed. They'll shrink, the meat will shrink down and the bones will stick out a little bit and then they're done. I have to wash my hands. So these are the ribs. See how easily they're moving on the grill? See that? No sticking at all. So I'm looking here to see everything's okay. We're still in business. The ribs are done. And the way I can tell is instinct and also the fact that the bones are starting to come exposed. And when I touch it, it feels like this. Rare, medium, well done. And I've taken these off about 15 minutes before I want people to eat them. And I'm gonna take them in and lightly tent them with tinfoil. And they will be perfect when my guests arrive. Because they rested for 15 minutes, they're warm, but they're not nuclear because then they can't eat them. I've had complaints about the ribs being too hot. Basically, you don't want to serve it in a dirty dish, so you're just going to quickly wipe it down, and then you are simply going to insert a sharp knife into this dish, like this. And if you would like, you can put a little sprig of parsley there, if you want. So your guests are either about to arrive or they are arriving. It's time to preheat your oven so that you can put the tarts in at the correct time. I'm just gonna tell you a tip. You can follow all of this tart cooking business and you can serve them room temperature. You can do it any time today. If you wanna do it so that they're hot or that they're cooking when they come in because it's kinda nice, do it the way we're gonna do it tonight. But you can really cook these at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and just serve them at room temperature. Here are your tarts, beauties that they are. You're gonna take a little sort of whisked egg. And without being too fussy, you want to do this quickly so that you don't lose any of the chill on the pastry, okay? So you're very quickly painting the sides. Go ahead and be liberal, because the more egg wash, the more shine. It doesn't matter if it goes in the little nooks and crannies. It's kind of nice, actually, if it does that. The Queen of Hearts, she made some tarts all on a summer's day. So you're just looking for the pastry to be very puffy and beautiful around it and brown. I'll show you. It's time to grill your chicken, and it's called chicken under a brick or Italian chicken or lemon chicken. But basically what you're gonna do is you're gonna place your chicken on the grill and you're gonna put a cookie tray on and then you put the brick on top of the cookie tray. If you don't have that, you can put the brick directly on the chicken, but the brick is gonna get gross, okay? I might even use two bricks to hold it down. What you're trying to do is keep the chicken down on the grill flat, okay? As flat as it can be. The two things we're gonna remember when we go out there is you do not touch it until it's time to move it, to flip it. No matter what happens, don't try to get it off the grill until you take off the cookie tray and flip it. Trust me, 14 minutes aside, do what I tell you and it's gonna come out perfect. You want a medium hot grill, okay? Pretty hot so that you can't really keep your hand on it too long. Like that is about as long as I can keep my hand on it. You are going to position this presentation side up, which means skin side up. So here we go, ready? Skin side up. Okay, position it as good as you can. Don't panic. Here we go. Don't panic. I'm setting a timer, 14 minutes, you're gonna flip it. Okay, time to flip the chicken. This is dramatic. We have to pick this up and get it off the chicken, which is not easy. And then we have this rather delicate task of flipping a half-cooked chicken. I'm gonna use two sets of tongs. It came apart, that's okay. That's all you need to know. Don't look at it, don't think about it for 14 minutes, okay? We're gonna slice two lemons in half, and we're gonna grill the meat side down on the grill until they're cross-hatched with grill marks, and you serve it with the chicken, it's beautiful. And we're gonna set them on the hottest part of the grill, which is usually at the back. And we're gonna sort of burn them, okay? And they get grill marks on them. And then when you squeeze that lemon juice, it's like grilled lemon juice, and you squirt it all over the chicken, it's off the chain. I'm just gonna close this up. I've been opening and closing my medium hot to hot grill. The reason I do that is I'm looking under the pan at the chicken, and I want it to be crispy, but I don't want it to be incinerated. So I'm closing it occasionally. I have a dial. If you don't have a dial, trust me, you can tell when it's really hot. Let it get super, super, super hot, but you don't want it to be a kiln. You're not doing pots in here. You don't want it to be like dust. So every now and again, you're gonna just let out a little bit of heat in your 14 minutes. This should be unpleasant to stand next to, heat-wise. Like, I can't show you how long I can keep my hand in there. I mean, it's really hot. So every now and again, I'm letting the chicken sort of be outside and then get hot again. The chicken is ready. What we're gonna do is remove the sheet pan and the bricks. I mean, does it get better than that? Pick up the pieces of chicken, which should be perfection right now, dripping with juice as they are. Oops. Come on, little feller. I mean, come on, man. And I'm gonna take these grilled lemons and I'm gonna take one of them and I'm gonna squeeze it on all the chicken. So one of them can't be used in presentation, okay? So I'm squeezing the lemon onto the chicken. The other two can be used in presentation, and your guests can squeeze it on if they want. This is a meal they will not forget. What we're gonna do is we're just gonna clean the plate a little bit. So you wanna make it look like it was made just for them, and it was cooked by fairies. In other words, you don't want it to have any mess on it. We're gonna hit this with a tiny bit more lemon. Oh, lemon chicken. Oh! And we want some green here because it's a very lovely brown and yellow dish. So we're gonna put some parsley in there. Leo, stop. He likes to catch flies and chew them. Like your friends might like to chew this chicken. Chew the chicken, friends. The tarts are ready. Do you know how you know they're ready? I'll tell you. They look ready. Those are ready. The pastry's puffed, separated from the sides. The onion is crispy. You can set these down to cool because your friends are gonna bug out. These are your tomatoes that have been commingling and weeping on each other for a couple of hours. For the last 40 minutes, you can put them in the fridge so that they're nice and chilled. So you're just gonna take off the cellophane like this, and you're going to take the basil leaves that we picked up in the garden or from the store, and you're just gonna rip up basil leaves like this. Con rustico, like the country, right? It just gives a wonderful sort of minty flavor. Now that said, you can also rip up a couple of mint leaves in here if you want. We're not doing that today. Okay, so this is a gorgeous tomato salad. Everybody will love it. And then the clincher is you take this piece of proper mozzarella, not the mozzarella that comes, see how easily this breaks apart? That's how mozzarella is supposed to be. And you're gonna do this, okay? You're just gonna cut pieces of it and drop them on the salad. No big deal, okay? I'm gonna drop pieces of mozzarella, comme ça, la, la. You have now cut burrata on, look at this, it couldn't be more gorgeous. Look at the liquid, it has its own dressing. Whoa, okay? Now because the burrata is quite white, we're just going to crack a little extra pepper on top of that. This could not be more delicious. This is your green salad, beautiful. And this is your very special dressing that you created. Now, I'm just gonna flip this a little bit. You can see there's quite a lot of liquid besides the tomatoes, okay? Your choice, depending on your meal. You can either just put this on with the tomatoes, which is lovely, or you can kind of put only the liquid on. I'm just gonna taste it really quickly. It's really good. I'm gonna go ahead and put the tomatoes on because they're gorgeous and it's summer. And I'm just gonna go like this. But don't forget they have dressing. Now you don't wanna overdress it. Your friends can always ask for more dressing. They can't ask for less dressing. And then I'm gonna put a tiny bit of dressing. Nothing worse than an overdressed salad. Toss it un peu. Oh my God. A little mustard in there. Delicioso. Panna cotta. Okay, so you can either serve it in the thing you made it in, which is perfectly acceptable, or you can decant it. I'm gonna decant one for you. So I'm gonna take one of these, and here's a little trick. You get a little basin of warm water, and you put your panna cotta in that for a few seconds. Then you take a knife like this, you run it around the edges of your panna cotta, and you tip it out on the plate. You see how it's flecked with vanilla? I'm gonna take a tiny spoonful of lemon curd because it's quite intense, and I'm just going to drop it on top like that. Cover any mistakes you might have made decanting it. Panna cotta should quite aggressively move when you tap it, and in the dish it should jiggle, okay? Panna cotta, why not? We really want to thank you for watching this episode of Dinner Party Tonight, Summer Evening Supper.
S-E-S.
And we ask you to please leave any comments that you have below, and you can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or here on YouTube. And I would also like to tell you that you can do parts of a recipe, half of it, some of the dinner, just have somebody over, just entertain. It'll change your life and it'll change your friend's life. And that's the main message of Dinner Party Tonight. invite your friends over. Doo 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 doo.